हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, अनदर मिनट एंड वी शुड बी स्टार्टिंग विद द सेशन। कैन एवरीवन सी मी, हियर मी प्रॉपरली? Cool guys, so almost everyone can hear me properly, can see me properly. I think it's 5 o'clock and we are good to go. Okay, so basically we are here for corporate restructuring classes. Guys, I have a plan which has been clearly laid for these classes. And before I tell you the plan, let me explain you how this online concept would work for you. So we would be sharing notes with you, as well as I will be sharing some PPTs with you guys. And you have to carefully hear to what I'm talking to you, to what I'm telling you. You may make notes of those things in your books. And obviously it is available here in recording, so you can see those things later as well, as and when you want to see. As per your time convenience, you can go and see all those things. And then if there is any doubts, problems, you can come back to me anytime. Now, all of you, if you have any questions while I'm teaching you the subjects, any information that you want to share with me, there's this chat option which is available. You all can go and just type your questions there. And I shall be answering all your questions there. Okay, I shall be doing what? I shall be making sure that whatever questions are asked in this particular column, you are being answered here. Now guys, today, since it's an introductory session, it's not much to talk about in terms of how it would go and all. But from tomorrow onwards, there would be few questions which would be there for you guys. And few preview of the notes would be given to you. Okay, so you have to read and make sure that you prepare for those particular topics, so that in the class when we are studying those particular topics, it's a clear cut understanding of the subject matter which is there between us. So this is how it would be going ahead. We have to make sure that you are reading whatever is taught in the class. Guys, if you don't study, okay, if you don't read it, you would not be given access to my class. And I am clear on that. I would be deciding who would get access and who would not get access. You have to keep reading on whatever topics are being taught here. Okay, so that is very, very important for you to follow. Now, the second thing, guys, since it's an online session which is happening here, we obviously need to develop our writing skills as well for the answers. You know, so what I shall be doing is I shall be uploading question papers for you guys, to which you would be writing answers and sending it across to me, okay, through mails. I would be seeing your, I would be just scanning your answers. My intent is not that, you know, I get to know whether you know the content or not. My intent is I should understand whether you're able to write those answers in the exams or not. Okay, so that is how it goes. Now, let's start with corporate restructuring. Old syllabus, group one. Now, one of the toughest subject, okay, which I believe in group one is company law. And second one is corporate restructuring. It just does not go with company law and corporate restructuring. I mean, it just does not go with the group. It goes with the entire 9 papers which are there. The most toughest of the papers which are there are corporate restructuring and company law. Ma'am, how do we read these papers? So as and when time would come, I'll tell you how to read these papers and how to study the problem. Now today, when I start this class, usually I give a subject strategy, but there is a change in the subject strategy this time. Reason is simple. So the last paper of the corporate restructuring, which was there in the exam, I think pretty much section A and section C was something people were able to manage. But something that they were not able to manage was part B. Now, what was the problem with part B? So we actually have solved almost all the questions in part B. It's not that we have not solved. But the question which appeared in the exam, it was altogether a surprise in the exam. The question that appeared was from ICWA material. And CWA cost accountant, for them, it's fine. That those doing those valuations is fine. But they were not definitely of the levels of a CS. So till now, my concentration was, let's study part A completely and perfectly. Because that would ensure what? That would ensure you to get 50 marks out of the subject. And then you should be thorough with part B also, because two chapters and 30 marks. So this 70 marks were really, really helpful for the students to get very good marks. Part C, usually I'll tell students not to concentrate that much, in the sense, because the efforts that you put for part C and the results that are there is pretty much, the balance is not there. So it's for 20 marks, it's almost 7 chapters which are there. So it's too much. It's just too much. And those 7 chapters are not easy chapters. You have insolvency and bankruptcy code. You have winding up. You have securitization. You have all the big acts, which actually themselves are like, huge into study. So that's where the problem is. Okay. The subject, the part C has only 20 marks and some 6-7 chapters, and each chapter is huge in size. But I obviously have to come up with a new strategy now, and I shall be sharing my strategy very soon with you. Maybe a day or two, and you'll get the new strategy how you are supposed to study. But one thing which is common in the old strategy and new strategy is one that is part A you have to study thoroughly. So there is no go in which you are missing on part A. Abhi ma'am, what are important topics in part A? So when I talk about part A, guys, so in part A, the important topics which are there, mergers and amalgamations. So I'm just not talking about chapter 2, merger and amalgamation. I'm talking about all the aspects of mergers and amalgamation. Okay, which includes which all things, which includes your stamp duty. You're not able to hear me. Are you guys not able to hear me, guys? Are you not able to hear? I got a message from Santosh saying that he's not able to hear me. Shravani can hear me. I can hear. Sukarne also can hear. I think there's some problem at your end, Santosh. Just check once. Yeah. Everyone can hear except for Santosh. Santosh, please check at your end. Can you hear me now, Santosh? Okay, everyone can hear. So, Santosh, there is some problem at your end. Just check once. Okay, guys. So, what I was trying and telling you was a simple thing, that, you know, when we talk about mergers and amalgamation, you have to study the stamp duty aspect, the taxation aspect, you know, the every aspect which is covered under mergers and amalgamation is one of the important topics. The second most important topic that is there is takeover. Okay. And the third most important topic is buyback. These are the three most financial restructuring. Basically, the chapter name is financial restructuring. So these are the three most important chapters which are there for you guys. This is, I'm talking about part A. Part B, guys, everything is important because it's just two chapters and 30 marks. But the problem with part B is theory is manageable. Practical till now was also manageable because they were asking the same type of question every year. But in the last exam, okay, something new has happened and they have asked a question altogether a different level questions. So we cannot, you know, trust anymore on practical. It's good. If easy question comes in exam, it's well and good. But if it doesn't, it's a big problem. So part B, we are completely concentrating on theory. Part C, important chapters is insolvency and bankruptcy code. Winding up. So guys, I have told you five chapters. I'm repeating the name of those five chapters. Mergers, amalgamations and its various aspects. Takeover. Okay. Then next one is your buyback. Okay. After buyback is your part B. And part C, six chapters basically. For part C is your IBC and what? Winding up. So these are the chapters which are the most important chapters. So now our strategy for the subject is very simple. I have to make sure that these six chapters that we just spoke about, I know in and out about these chapters. Guys, can you make sure that you know these six chapters after my teaching in and out? If your answer is yes, you're sorted for corporate restructuring. But if your answer is no, then you're not sorted for this subject. So if I have to tell you the weightage for these six topics or seven topics to be precise, because part B has two chapters, basically, the weightage for this is 70 to 80 marks. I repeat, the weightage for these 7 to 8 chapters are 70 to 80 marks. Pick up any exam paper and you can find the same thing there. It is 70 to 80 marks which comes from these 5 or 6 chapters. So we have to make sure what? That these 6 or 7 chapters that we just spoke about, we know in and out about those chapters. So change in strategy again. I have told you, we are not following the strategy which was followed in previous exams, because according to me, this strategy would work better. After analyzing last 4 or 5 attempt paper, to be precise. I hope you have noted these chapters that I spoke about. Repeating the name of the chapters, if you have not noted, please note the name of the chapters. 1. Mergers and amalgamations and its various aspects. Accounting aspect, taxation aspect, stamp duty aspect, all those aspects I'm talking about. 2. Takeover. 3. Buyback of securities or financial restructuring. The chapter is called as financial restructuring in your books. 4th one, which is important, is part B, both chapters. Okay. So the valuation chapters, both the chapters are important. In part C, what is important? IBC, insolvency and bankruptcy code, winding up. So these are the important chapters that we need to study. Are you clear with this? Did you understood this? Now guys, one of the most important chapter that I'm gonna starting, I would be starting is mergers and amalgamation, that is starting from tomorrow. So do not miss on your classes, because mergers and amalgamations is very, very important being a CS, just not from theory point of view, just not from exam point of view. But when you become a CS, you would go there and do what? You would be doing all these things practically. So I have worked for a company and my first project as a CS was demerger of the company. Which means the chapter which we'll start from tomorrow. On an average, we should take 3 to 4 days to finish that particular chapter. Okay, because my concept is simple, guys. When I know what is important, I would be stressing too much on those chapters to make sure that it is done and dusted in the class itself, on the online platform itself, it's done and dusted. And once that is done, okay, all other chapters are really simple. I don't know much about you people, especially few like Sapna, Karthik, Santosh. I don't know whether you're writing all groups, you're writing one group, you're writing, how are you writing? So if you're writing all groups, guys, okay, what happens is you have very limited time. Okay, yes. So you have Karthik, you are writing through all three groups. So in that case, you have a limited time. You have to do the smart study mechanism. Otherwise, it's very difficult to clear all three. And how do you do that? It is a very simple procedure. Make sure you do what? You know which all chapters you are supposed to study. Again, Sapna is writing all three. So that is where the problem is. Karthik, you are asking me about test. I have already told you, repeating again. I shall be sending you question papers to which answers are supposed to be uploaded by you guys. Okay, once you upload the answer, I'll give you feedback on what is wrong in your answer books. But if you tell me that, you should sit and check my papers, it's impossible for me to do that because it's an online session that we are taking. What I can do best is you write the papers, you've uploaded, I'll tell you what mistakes you're doing in your papers and you can work on those mistakes. You can work on improving how to write the answers to those questions. Test mostly would be happening every Saturdays. Every Saturday you'll get a question paper. And for the people who do not upload the answer books, okay, they do not get access to the next class. It is very simple. Because it doesn't make sense where you do what, you try and attend classes, learn nothing out of the classes. So it's simple. You first do what? You first upload the answers to those questions and next I give you the access to the next books. Am I clear with the concepts or not? Am I clear what are we supposed to, how are we supposed to study this subject? Now guys, tomorrow I shall be sharing with all of you, one schedule for the entire classes because I'm still working on the schedules, how it goes, where it goes and all those. And you can pretty much see what is that is taught each day and accordingly be prepared for those particular topics. Prepared in the sense you can at least, go through the scanners, see the scanner ones, so that we are aware that what type of questions has been asked in those particular chapters. Clear, guys? Any questions till now? Any questions, anyone? Okay, cool. No questions. Cool. So guys, when I talk about corporate restructuring, so this is the first subject that we are supposed to start today. First chapter that we are going to starting today is corporate restructuring introduction. Okay, I would give access to all of you. I am actually unmuting all of you all. Okay, so you can answer the questions that I'm telling you now. All right, so you can answer. You just have to speak wherever you are sitting. Okay, so you can just speak and do what? Listen to this and tell me what is it, how it is. Now guys, what according to you is corporate restructuring? I've unmuted all of you so you can answer the questions. What is corporate restructuring? No one? What according to you is corporate restructuring, guys? Okay. All right, guys. So let me come to you on what is corporate restructuring. Corporate, which means what? An organization, a company, right? Okay. Corporate restructuring, which means what? Changes in the organization. Now, what does changes means? Shifting your desk from one side to another. Answer is no. Okay. You cannot hear me, guys?
We can.
I can hear.
We can.
Okay. Shravani? Shravani? Shravani, can you hear me? Okay, I think we have lost. I don't know. Okay, guys. So basically, what is corporate restructuring? Corporate, which means organization. Here it is specifically company that we are talking about, and corporate restructuring. Now, what is corporate restructuring? So restructuring means changes. Guys, in an organization, there are two types of growths which are there. Anyone knows which are the two types of growth or two ways of growth in the organization?
Organic and inorganic.
Perfect. So this is organic and inorganic. What is organic growth? What is organic growth? What is organic growth?
Within the company itself.
Organic growth, see, everything is within the company. Okay. Mm-hmm. So if I talk about, let's say my financial capital, I'm changing the structure. Is it within the organization? Answer is yes. Okay. What is organic? Organic means something which is natural. Okay. Natural growth of the company. Today, if I've started a business, guys, this business would scale, let's say, in 3 years, 4 years. Right? Yes. Right? Okay. Can it scale in the day two itself? Today I started business and tomorrow my business is like another Amazon or another Flipkart. Not possible. No. Right? It takes its usual time for the company's growth, and that is called as what? Organic growth. What is inorganic growth? Inorganic means which is not natural. It is done with the help of something. Okay, which is done with the help of some either other person, or there's some structural changes that you have made because of which the growth all of a sudden has happened. Okay, so that is called as what? Inorganic growth. It is not natural. It is all of a sudden that the growth happens. So when we talk about corporate restructuring, it is an inorganic form of growth. What form of growth? Inorganic form of growth. Where my organization is not growing naturally. My organization is growing because of what? Some inorganic means. What are those inorganic means? Mergers, amalgamation, takeover, demerger. Okay. Then slum sale. All these are what? All these are corporate restructure. So did you get the concept of what is corporate restructuring?
Yes.
When an inorganic, okay, growth is happening for the company, and when the company is doing what? Trying and growing with the help of some inorganic mechanism, and it is trying and making changes in it. Obviously, because of this inorganic courses, automatically what would happen? Changes would happen in the organization. Growth would happen in the organization. So when these changes happen, this is called as what? This is called as corporate restructuring, guys. Guys, for today's class, I'm not sharing the notes with you because, you know, a few people are taking demo and all. So once, it's a regular session, maybe from tomorrow, you would get notes available on your screen. So you can read everything in those notes and make a point of what? Of all those in your notebooks. So it becomes what? Very easy for you to understand those concepts. So guys, after explaining you what is corporate restructuring, okay, the next important thing that we need to understand is how is this corporate restructuring done? How can I go ahead and do what? Do the corporate restructuring. So the various ways of corporate restructuring are mergers, demerger, slum sale, franchisee. Okay. Next is disinvestments, takeover, demerger, amalgamation, and guys, strategic alliance. Now, before I start with chapter one, guys, let me give you an overview of chapter one. What are we supposed to study in chapter number one? So guys, when I talk about chapter one, first we would be studying about what is corporate restructuring, what is the objective and scope of corporate restructuring, what is the advantage of corporate restructuring, and what are the various ways of corporate restructuring. Ma'am. Yes, Karthik, I can hear what you are telling. It's very much audible to me. I think you only answered what is organic and what is inorganic. So I can hear you very clearly. It's not a problem. You can definitely keep asking questions to me. Okay, you can type here as well. That's not a problem. Okay, all right, guys. So what are we supposed to study in this chapter? First, what is corporate restructuring? Second, we are supposed to study the objectives and scope of corporate restructuring, advantages of corporate restructuring, and the fourth and the most important topic is ways of corporate restructuring. Now, guys, they would never ask you what are the various ways of corporate restructuring. That is like too dumb question to be asked in CS professionals. How will they ask the questions? So basically, one of the type of question that comes is on, they'll give you a definition of corporate restructuring in some quotes, and at the end they'll ask you to comment. So one of the common questions that comes from this chapter is a comment question. Okay, one of the common questions that comes from this chapter is comment question. Second type of question they may ask you, and they mostly ask, is about the last topic that I just spoke, the types of corporate restructuring. So types or various ways of corporate restructuring basically means what? How can I do corporate restructuring? So they may ask you, write a short note on franchisee model. Write a short note on, let's say, strategic alliance. What is the difference between any two topics? They'll give and ask the difference. So the most important topic, guys, I classify my chapters into three types. Five-star, 3-star and 1-star. 5-star are the most important chapters. 3-star are okay chapters, and 1-star are important chapters. So 5-star chapters are, I have already given you a list of those 7 chapters which are 5-star chapters, right? 3-star chapters are chapters, I will tell you in between which are 3-star chapters. So this chapter 1 is which type of chapter? This is 1-star chapter. This is which type of chapter? This is 1-star chapter. Just give me for a chapter 1 is which type of chapter? It's a 1-star chapter. Am I clear with this or no? Yes? Okay. What is the important topic in chapter 1? I've already told you. Guys, all these small things that I'm telling you now would really help you to get better marks and to understand what topics you should concentrate. Please make a note of it. For example, I told you, in first chapter, what are the most important topics? Ways of corporate restructuring. And second one is what? The first topic that is on corporate restructuring, they ask a comment question. Am I clear with this? Okay, guys. So let's start with chapter 1 now. Give me a second, guys.
Yes.
Can you see the notes which are coming on the screen?
No, you're seeing your photo. Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Lesson 1, corporate restructuring, introduction and concepts. Can you see that?
Yes, ma'am.
Cool. Okay, guys. So if anyone is not able to see, please let me know about what, about that. I would show you again. So I've already discussed with you that in an organization, there are two ways in which organization can grow. One is organic concept and second is non-organic. Okay. Organic basically means what? You're trying and making changes within the organization and you're trying and growing, and it's a natural growth which is happening in the organization. Non-organic means what? A change, okay, that happens. Why? Because you are merging with another entity, you're collaborating with another entity, and because of which both the organizations grow together. So that is called as non-organic growth. So basically, guys, when I talk about corporate restructuring, it can be both. It can be organic as well as non-organic. Organic corporate restructuring means what? Changes within the organization. Can someone give me some example of it?
Financial restructuring.
Perfect. Buyback of securities. Any of the financial restructuring, that is internal or organic corporate restructuring. Non-organic corporate restructuring means what? Mergers, amalgamations. Yes. Okay, all that goes under which category? Under non-organic corporate restructuring. Now, if I ask you guys, why do we need corporate restructuring? What is the need of the corporate restructuring? Can someone tell me this? Why do we need corporate restructuring?
Competition.
Okay, so one of the reason is competition. Fine.
Diversification,
okay.
Development,
okay. Fine, growth and developments.
Better use of resources.
Okay, so this is one of the major reasons why do we go for corporate restructuring. Okay, one, obviously mine is an organization where we have extra cash available, but there is no projects which are available. There is one organization which has a lot of projects available, but they do not have cash. So the two organizations come together and do what? Form a synergy. All right. So why? What is the objective of corporate restructuring? First one is what? Orderly redirection of the firm's activity. So you want to redirect the firm's activity. You go for what? Corporate restructuring. Usually when you want to redirect the firm's activity, you go for organic corporate restructuring. That is internally you are trying and making changes in the organization. Okay. So you would not take help of the other organization for doing what? For redirecting your activities. You may take help of experts to do this, but usually no other company would be employed in doing this. Second, I've already told you, mine is a business. I have no projects, but I have surplus cash. So to deploy that surplus cash, I go for what? Corporate restructuring. Third, exploiting interdependency among present or prospective business. Interdependency means what? I am supplying raw material to someone. Okay. The two companies merge and become one company. So right from raw material to the finished goods, it's manufactured at one place in the one company name and it is just going from there. Risk reduction. How? Because now it is not just you who is taking the risk. There's one more organization which is involved with you to take the risk. And last, most important thing is development of corporate core competencies. What is core competency?
Your main activity.
The main skill that you have. It's not main activity, the skill, competence. The main okay. thing which gives you a competing edge over your what? Over your competitors is called as core competence. For example, Apple, what is the core competencies they have? Exactly. In their mobiles, okay, the usage, the experience that you get to get through iPhone, not get through other phones. So that is their core competencies. And they're working on their core competencies more and more and developing a better and better experience for their what? For their customers. So you are you'll try and develop on your core competencies. How? You should ask me this question, guys. How? Can someone answer this question? How through corporate restructuring I can develop core competencies?
You acquire some other companies having the same product.
So that way you are reducing competition and increasing monopoly. But how is this helping in core competency?
Vertical integration. You are buying a supply distribution.
That doesn't help. That doesn't help to develop your core competency. That helps in exploiting interdependency. Yes, this point, what you are saying, I agree. But not for developing core competency.
What about our R&D, research and development? Any organization engaged
in
that?
Not necessarily every corporate restructuring would lead to that. That would be very specific. I am asking in general, how can you develop a core? Okay, should I give you a hint?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, guys. So, suppose you are supposed to, obviously you're supposed to study for CS. You are supposed to do household chores. You are supposed to take care of outside world also. You're supposed to socialize also. You're supposed to take care of your parents also. Now, in all these things, what is your core competence? What is your
core?
Studying, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Doing CS. Now, what? How a corporate restructuring can help you doing your CS? So here, your corporate restructuring would be in the form of a domestic
time management.
Correct. The moment somebody comes and helps you to do other things, you can concentrate on your core activity. Similarly, in the company also, if someone joins you, someone helps you to take care of the other activities, you can just concentrate on your main
outsourcing
competency. Sorry, come again.
Outsourcing, would you outsource your non-core activities so that you can concentrate on your core?
So, when you outsource your non-core activity, what happens is, first of all, you have to identify what is core and what is non-core. Here, you're not outsourcing. What are you trying and doing here is, you're trying and merging with another company who would take care of all the other activities and you would take care of core competencies. So that way, it would help you in doing what? It would help you in working better for all these particular aspects. Did you get the concept or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Understood? Okay. Now, what is the scope? Why corporate restructuring? The scope for the business is always to reduce cost, increase profits. Right? This is why we do business. So that is the scope of corporate restructuring as well. So guys, till now we have studied three things. One, what is corporate restructuring? So that is nothing but you are trying and restructuring or reworking on your organizational structure. There are two types of growth in the organization, organic and inorganic. Inorganic happens basically through what? Through corporate restructuring. Again, corporate restructuring, inorganic corporate restructuring is what? It is something which is related with external world. And organic corporate restructuring is something which is related within the organization. So this is something which is natural. Over a time period, you have to do that particular thing. What is the need? One, to redirect the firm's activity. Second, surplus cash. Third, interdependency, risk reduction, and core competence development. Are you clear with the concepts or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, cool. Now, guys, comes the most important part of this chapter, which is methods of implementation of corporate restructuring. So how can I implement corporate restructuring in the organization? The first one all of us know, and it's very, very common, which is merger. What is merger? Two companies becoming one. Two companies coming together and doing what? Becoming one company. Both the companies can lose their existence, or one or more company can lose their existence. Are you clear with the concept or not?
Yes.
Now, my question to all of you here is, what is the difference between merger and amalgamation? Or is there no difference between the two? What is the difference between merger and amalgamation? Karthik, I'll mail you these notes the moment the institute tell me to do that. So don't worry on notes. You'll get all the notes. Everything you'll get. You'll get PPTs also, which would help you to understand the concepts in more precise manner. Fine?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So what is there any difference between mergers and amalgamation? First question, yes or no for this?
Yes. Yes, there is a difference.
Yes, there is a difference. Okay. Then if there is a difference, what is the difference? Is my question. You all said yes. You have to answer this question. If there is a difference, what is the difference between the two? No idea?
In amalgamation, the amalgamated entity does not exist. The transferee company exists and transferor company ceases to exist.
Okay, I'm hearing. Keep telling.
And mergers. Yes. An example that I can think of is IDEA and Escotel.
Okay.
So IDEA and Escotel merged and they agreed to share profits with each other. So
my dear, I want you to read this statement. Merger is fusion or absorption of one thing or rights into another. Thus, merger is an arrangement whereby the assets of two or more companies become vested in or under the control of one company, which may or may not be the original two companies. Now, still you find the same difference to be applicable? Okay, guys, I'll tell you the difference because most of you don't know it. So when I talk about mergers and amalgamation, there is no difference between the two. The biggest myth is merger basically means two companies coming together and one company losing its existence, or both the companies losing its existence and coming and forming a new company. Okay, and amalgamation basically means one company losing its entity, blah, 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 blah. There is no such difference. Merger and amalgamation is same. It can be anything. Two companies merging together and the two of them losing their entity, losing their existence and forming a new company. Anything can be there in merger and amalgamation. The difference is only from income tax point of view. So in income tax, they have basically differentiated between the two. Otherwise, there is no difference which has been created amongst what? Among amalgamation and merger. Both are same. Both's procedure is same. In both of them, accounting treatment is also same. However, income tax treatment is different, and that's why they have named it two mergers and amalgamation. Otherwise, two of them are same. Did you get the concept or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Cool. So when we talk about mergers, mergers are basically of two types. Horizontal merger, vertical merger. Horizontal merger basically means what? At the same levels. We have a very recent one. Can someone give me an example? Horizontal at same levels. Same levels.
Bank. Banks,
India Bank. Other companies also manufacturing. If I am distributing, other companies also distributing. If I am a raw material supplier, the other companies also a raw material supplier.
Vijaya Bank, Dena Bank, BOB.
This is cool. The latest one, Vodafone and Idea. Right? Vodafone, yes. Idea. Both of them at the same level. Same levels doesn't mean same business levels. Same sales level. Same level here means they are doing the same type of what? Same type of activities. So that is called as what? Horizontal mergers. Vertical merger. When you are merging with somebody who is a preceder of your product or who is a successor of your product. For example, I take raw material from X company, use that raw material and manufacture a product, supply it to Y company, and Y company sells it in the market. Did you get the concept or not? So here, when we are doing this, okay, it is called as what? When you are merging either with the supplier of raw material or with the marketing entity, it is called as what? Vertical merger. Am I clear with horizontal or vertical merger or not?
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Let's see the here. Horizontal merger means merger between firms manufacturing same products, providing same services, or distributing same products. That is between business competitors. Example, Bank of Rajasthan, ICICI Bank. I just now gave you an example. Okay, vertical merger. It means merger between firm in different stages of production operations. I just now told you this concept. Different stages of production operations. I am manufacturing. Somebody is a supplier or marketing guy. HUL, they don't manufacture anything. They just market the product and supply it in the market. Or raw material supplier. If I integrate with them, that is called as what? Vertical merger. Now, this vertical merger can be of two types. Forward or backward. Backward means what? Merger with whom?
Predecessor.
Okay. Merger with my predecessor, which means my raw material supplier. Okay. Basically, if I talk about my example that I was giving. What about forward looking? What about forward looking? Sorry?
With your marketing and distribution channels.
Okay, cool. With your marketing or distribution channel. Okay, so these are what? These are the various types of merger. Now, guys, apart from this, the classification that has been given is co-generic and conglomerate merger. Guys, when I studied my CS, there was huge difference, and what is taught today, there is a huge difference. Santosh, audio issues still? Still, you can't hear me. Just check once your volume is full or not. Santosh, just check whether volume is proper or not. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Okay, cool. So basically, when I studied my CS, we had a very clear-cut classification of mergers. So what for us, the classification was, okay, I'll not tell you the classification. You yourself would tell whether this classification is correct or not. So conglomerate merger and co-generic merger. These are the other two types of mergers. Co-generic, what does this mean? Co-generic. In the same type of product line. Vodafone Idea. Both are telephone operators. Both are service provider, telephone service providers. If both of them are merging, which type of merger this is? Co-generic merger. In the same type of business field you are merging. That is called as what? Co-generic. ICICI Bank, Bank of Rajasthan. Co-generic. Both are in which business? Banking business, banking. Right? So therefore, it is what? It is co-generic merger. What is conglomerate mergers?
a bunch of unrelated industries.
So when you are merging with an unrelated company, when you are merging with a company which is not, whose business are totally unrelated with each other, that is called as what? It is called as co-conglomerate business. Now, to give you an example, Ola. Ola has taken over Food Panda, right? Ola has taken over Food Panda. Now, which type of merger is this?
Conglomerate.
Ola was in with services, cab services, and Food Panda was in with services, food industry. The two of them were not related, and since they have merged it, it is called as what? It is called as conglomerate mergers. Did you get the concept? Now, guys, some question should come from you here. If it doesn't come,
ma'am, so this co-generic and horizontal, aren't they the same?
That's why I told that your books have given a wrong classification. Actually, the classification should be merger, two types of merger. One, conglomerate. Second, co-generic. Co-generic is of two types, horizontal and vertical, right? Because what is vertical merger? You are merging with a person who is at a different operational scale. But is it related with your business? Answer is yes.
Yes.
It is related with your business. He was a raw material supplier to your business, or he was a marketer for your business, right? You're going and merging with that company. So ideally, the classification should be what? There are two types of merger, co-generic merger and conglomerate merger. Co-generic should be classified into two, horizontal and vertical. And vertical again should be classified as what? Forward and backward. Did you get the concept or not? Did you understand what I'm trying and telling you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, got it? Okay. So this is what is the various types of mergers which is there. Now, what is demerger, guys? What is demerger? What is meant by demerger?
Ma'am, one doubt.
Yeah, bolo.
Ma'am, when Ola is taking over Food Panda, I mean, both of them will be doing their independent businesses. Normal.
So the business has come under one company, that is Ola. And under Ola, you'll have separate sections, one for cab, one for food.
Okay.
Got it? You'll have different sectors in which you would be working. Got it?
Okay.
Any other question? Any other thing that you have not understood?
No.
Clear as apko?
Yes.
Okay, guys. Cool. So, what is demerger? What is demerger?
When a particular activity of a company is separately formed into a different entity, one activity
so
alone.
If a company is carrying out a business and a part of the business is separated from the main company, that is called as what? Demerger. Live example, guys, try and give correct example, live examples. Okay, which actually are happening. Things that are actually happening, you should do what? You should use those. So the first one that is there is what? Merger of Syntex Plastic, demerger of Syntex Plastic from Syntex Industries. Syntex Industries was into what? It was into clothes, and you have seen Syntex Plastic tanks which are kept at the top of your buildings. Black tanks,
yes.
Right? Plastic tank. Those are manufactured by Syntex. So they were, both the businesses were in the main company, that is Syntex Industries. Slowly, what did they do? They demerged the Syntex Plastic business and formed a separate company called a Syntex Plastic Company. Guys, not to worry. We'll study all this in very much detail. Okay, as each chapter comes, these all things would be studied in much, much detail than what is taught here. Clear, guys? Okay. Next is reverse merger. Can someone tell me what is reverse merger?
When a profit-making company merges with a sick company.
Profit making company, okay. Karthik, tell me.
Yeah, the same thing.
Same thing. Okay, guys. So again, for your understanding, I'll classify reverse merger into two types. One is what you have said. What is normal merger? What is merger? When I talk about mergers, what is merger? So in merger, what happens is a loss-making entity would go and merge in which entity? In profit-making entity. Right? You are making losses. You have to come and merge in my company. I'll never come and merge in your company. Right? But when I talk about reverse merger, what happens in that particular case? In reverse merger, the loss-making entity would be standing as it is and the profit-making entity would come and merge in that particular entity. Repeating again. The profit-making entity would go and merge in which? In loss-making entity, that is called as reverse merger. Why? We'll study that later. The reason I'll tell you later. But there is one more aspect of what? Of reverse merger. What is that aspect? When an unlisted company and listed company is there, what is normal merger that would happen?
Unlisted.
One listed company, one unlisted company, who would go and merge in whom?
Unlisted would go and merge with the listed company.
Correct. Unlisted would go and merge with listed entity. In reverse merger, the listed entity goes and merges in unlisted company. Did you get the concept? What is it? First, understand the concept, then I'll tell you the reason for both of them. So one is where a loss-making entity, a profit-making entity. A profit-making entity goes and merges with what? With a loss-making entity. Whose existence still remains? Loss-making entity's existence still remains. An unlisted company and a listed company. But a listed company goes and merges with what? With your unlisted company, and that is called as what? That is called as your reverse merger. Now, obviously, the question comes, why? Why will anyone do this? So why will anyone go and do a merger of listed company into unlisted company? Think and tell me, guys. Why? Can you tell me? No one has the answer. Okay, guys. So why a unlisted entity would still remain and listed entity would lose its existence? Because unlisted company wants to become a listed entity without coming for an IPO. Automatically, when listed company would go and merge with the unlisted entity, unlisted company has to compulsorily get itself listed. So without an IPO, you are getting yourself listed, and that's why they go for which merger? Reverse merger. Are you clear with the concept or not? Second, why will a profit-making entity go and merge with a loss-making entity? The answer is simple. Tax. Tax saving. So I am a loss-making entity. A profit-making entity comes and merges with me. Their profits would be offsetted with the losses that I have. Okay, and that's where loss-making entity continues its existence and it's called as what? Reverse merger. Are you clear with the concept or not? Understood? Cool, guys. So reverse merger is also clear. What is slump sale, guys? This is very, very normal. You have studied this 100 times. What is slump sale? No idea?
You are not assigning values to individually to all the assets and liabilities. As a lump sum, you're fixing the consideration amount. And
it's a very simple example. I don't understand hi-fi languages. So it's a very simple thing. I went out. I saw mangoes. Okay, season of mango is coming. And I didn't buy 1 kg, 2 kgs. I said, give me the entire basket that you have or entire push cart which is there for mangoes. Just give it to me. And he said, okay, for the all the mangoes which are there, pay me 800 rupees. And you happily paid 800 and got it. What is this? Slump sale. Value is not assigned for per kg mangoes or anything. What has happened? Lump sum value has been given for the entire set of mango. It can be 10 kgs, it can be 5 kgs, it can be 7 kgs also. Okay, depends. But lump sum value has been paid by you. And that is called as what? That is called as your slump sale. So in the business, when you don't assign the values to your individual assets, this is my machine, how much it would cost? The moment you assign the value of how much the machine would cost, it does not become a slump sale, it becomes a normal sale. But you say, whatever machines you have, whatever equipment you have, whatever place you have, I'm ready to pay you 1 crore rupees for all of it. Okay, and that is called as what? It is called as slump sale. Usually slump sale is done for what? A part of a division. For example, my company has 3 divisions. I'm manufacturing staplers, I'm manufacturing pencils, I'm manufacturing papers also. Stapler industry, I don't want to continue anymore. So I give my stapler industry in a lump sum value, and that is called as what? That is called as slump sale. Clear, guys? Understood? Okay. Next one, disinvestment. It is the season of disinvestment this year. What is disinvestment?
Or a company takes out the money that they've invested in the company.
The government, okay. So basically, first of all, you have to understand. See, Karthik, if I tell you, you know the concepts, okay, but you know you're not using the right word, because of which you will not be able to score marks in the exams. Okay, so government may have investment in many companies. What is the big thing about it? So what is disinvestment basically? So in the government companies, okay, when the government is trying and selling their stake to the general public and basically doing what? Privatization of those companies. It is called as disinvestment. Are you clear with the concept? Karthik, did you understood what wrong statement you used?
Can you repeat it?
Okay, so when in a government company, the government is trying and selling its stake, okay, to the general public, leading to privatization, that is called as what? That is called as disinvestment. It is just not any company, please understand. It is a government-owned company, okay? Government may have stake in XYZ company, ABC company, LIC is, okay, through government has a lot of investment, right? In many companies, Reliance mein investment hai. Government is selling that is not disinvestment. But ONGC is a government company, okay? Oil and Natural Gas Agency, a corporation is a government company. So if they are selling stake in that particular company, it is called as disinvestment. Got it? Clear with the concept or not? So what is disinvestment? It refers to the transfer of the assets or service delivery from the government to the private sector. The concept of public sector undertaking disinvestment in different form, that is from minimum government investment to the private sector where the government has the majority. Okay, so what is important is you should tell that this is in the government company which it happens. Are you clear? Got the concept?
Yes.
So this is called as what? This is called as disinvestment. Government recently did it for ONGC. For many companies, they are doing what? Disinvestments. Now, guys, let's talk about what next. Takeover. What is takeover? What is takeover? What is takeover, guys? No idea?
In one company, business of another company.
Okay. So when one company acquires the other company, acquisition of one company by the other company is called as what? Takeover. The company, what is the difference between merger and takeover? What is the difference between the two?
In takeover, the company has its identity. So.
Okay, cool. So when I talk about takeover, the company still has its existence till there. Okay, whereas in merger, the company's existence comes to an end. Very well driven. Okay, so in takeover, you take the shares of the target company, the company in which you are trying and taking over, that is called as the target company. And the person who is acquiring it, it is called as the acquirer. So acquirer tries and takes the shares of that company, whereas the company's existence does not come to an end. Okay, so that is called as what? That is called as takeover. Clear, eh? Concept of takeover. Now guys, takeover is of two types, friendly and hostile takeover. What is friendly? Friendly is when, yeah, tell me.
You are entering.
Correct.
Entering into negotiations.
So what happens is, in friendly takeover, you are sitting and doing the negotiations. You are actually sitting and talking about the negotiations. For example, Jet Airways. Okay. Jet Airways is supposed to be taken by some airlines. A major stake is taken by some airlines. So they're sitting and doing what? They're sitting and negotiating on that particular aspect. And that is called as what? That is called as your friendly takeover. Where two parties sit together on a table, okay, over a cup of coffee, they decide and they discuss and then finally do what? Come up with the price on which the shares are to be acquired for that company. That is called as what? That is called as friendly takeover. What is hostile takeover? What is hostile takeover?
What is?
Hostile takeover. Hostile.
One company takes over another company without the permission of the shareholder.
Correct. When you slowly keep acquiring the shares of the company, okay, that is called as what? That is called as hostile takeover. Slowly you keep acquiring the shares and one fine day you tell that all the shares or majority of the shares are with us. So we'll take over to the management and that is called as what? Hostile takeover. You can see the two types of takeovers here, guys. Right?
Yes.
Okay. Next we are supposed to study is joint venture. Can someone tell me what is joint venture?
When two companies come together for a compromise for achieving one objective or something, either it can be for a time limit or for a till the project is complete or.
What is strategic alliance then? What is strategic alliance and what is the difference? So this is the most common question, guys, which is asked in the exam. This is the most common question. What is joint venture? What is strategic alliance? And what is the difference between the two? Any idea? No? Okay, guys. So when I talk about joint venture, these are the two companies. They have their separate entity. They are not merged, nothing. They come together and form a separate entity. Okay. The two companies form a separate entity, which is called as joint venture, where capital is invested by both the companies. Okay. Where capital is invested for by both the companies and they come together for a common purpose, one common purpose. Do they interfere in the working of each other? Answer is no. Do they have a right to say in each other's company? Answer is no. They've only come together for a specific purpose. So what happens? Two companies remain separate. They commonly float a company or a joint venture. They invest their capitals in that particular joint venture and they start doing something together. Whatever they want. Maruti Suzuki. It's a joint venture. Where Suzuki is supplying what? Engines to Maruti. And Maruti is manufacturing its own car. Is there any restriction? Suzuki can't manufacture anything in India. Blah, blah, blah. You are seeing so many Suzuki products also in India. Right? So this is joint venture. Now, bam. What is the difference between strategic alliance and joint venture? Strategic alliance, you don't form a separate entity. You just come together through an agreement that this is something we'll do together. Joint venture is for a longer duration. Strategic alliance is usually for a particular project, a particular purpose. Once the purpose is achieved, you are back to your normals. Okay. This happens through agreement. This happens through capital infusion. Okay, so that is the difference between joint venture and strategic alliances. Are you clear with the concept or not?
Yes.
Understood the difference between the two?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Cool. Next one is franchising. What is franchising? You all know it very well. So when you give the rights to manufacture your product, to supply your product in your own name, that is called as franchising. McDonald's, the most common example. The Cafe Coffee Day, Pizza Hut, Domino's, all these are franchisee model. Where you give your franchisee to the other person on a royalty basis and give him the right to manufacture the products that you are manufacturing. For example, Pizza Hut. So whatever pizzas, standard pizzas are available, the raw material would be supplied by them. Everything would be supplied to the pizza outlet and they would manufacture and supply it to the people whosoever are eating those pizzas. So this is called as what? This is called as franchisee. Okay. Where rights are given to use the business name as well as to manufacture those particular what? Are you clear with the concept or not? Understood, everyone? So, guys.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Any doubts, anyone? Okay, cool. All right, guys. So, did you understood the topics which are there?
Yes.
Okay. So, guys, here we complete with chapter one. Since today was a demo session which was there, we stop the class here itself. Tomorrow, it sessions which would be starting, okay, and you shall be getting for chapter one as well as two tomorrow. Once you are registered for the classes, you shall be getting the notes for those two chapters. Also tomorrow we shall be discussing the scanner for chapter one to see what type of questions has been asked for this particular chapter. And as I told, chapter one is a one star chapter. Hardly you will get 3 marks to 5 mark questions from this chapter. But again, every mark matter for us. So whichever, especially the easy chapters, we should not leave it. So do not leave this particular chapter. Did you get the concept or not? Everyone understood? Any questions you have? Any queries? No? Cool, guys. So we shall be ending the class here itself. Okay. And we shall be meeting tomorrow. 5 o'clock. Okay. I think the same login is to be used by you guys for this particular class. And tomorrow it's a full-fledged 3 hours class where we would be starting the most important topic, mergers and amalgamations. Okay. So tomorrow we have to be prepared and we have to be really, concentrate the best we can so that we understand the subject very well.
Chapter 2.
We shall be starting chapter 2. Any other questions?
That's all.
Okay, guys.
See, mail those notes.
Sorry?
Mail those notes.
You would get your notes as soon as the classes are registered. You are registered for the classes, you'll get all the notes. So tomorrow mostly you'll get all the notes. Today's as well as tomorrow's. Cool?
Yes.
Okay, guys. See you then tomorrow. Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye.